A very good morning to all of you. Welcome to all of you to today's class. Before starting the class, let's do Brahmanath. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Swastha. Open your eyes. Today, we are going to read your book 1, prose. So, in the very beginning, I have told you that your first unit, The Adventure of Learning, contains 4 chapters. First chapter was Memories of Crosscut School. Second chapter was Make Me a Child Again Just for Tonight. Say, third chapter was Confession of a Misspent Youth. And the fourth and last chapter is A Time to Think. Okay, means in this chapter we are going to read what is thinking, why it is mentioned a time to think, means something that we have to think. Okay, so now let's start the chapter. So dear students, today we are going to read the chapter A Time to Think. This is written by Edward D. Bono. Okay, but before it, let's focus on the title. What does it mean? A time to think. Initially, we may think that a time has come that we have to focus on something. We have to think on a strategic matter. Okay, we can take part in a serious discussion, and for that one we have to think. But this is not like that. The title is A Time to Think, but here it is completely different. We are not going to provide a time for thinking on a particular thing or a particular matter. But here, either you are providing specific time for thinking, okay? A serious matter is not there. Either time is allotted for thinking or not, that is the theme of this chapter. And this one is being written by Edward D. Bono, okay? So, whenever I am teaching you, you just go through the chapter. The 20th December 1982 issue of the Forbes USA carried a feature about me and lateral thinking. So here, in the very first line, the writer is focusing that in the year 1982, in the issue of the Forbes, there was an article on the writer as well as on thinking. Okay, so the particular chapter is thinking here. Since I know that subject reasonably well, what was of more interest to me was the second part of the feature in which several leading businessmen were asked about their thinking, their attitudes to thinking. So here, this chapter is quite well known to the writer, but still, the second part of the chapter was quite fascinating, was quite interesting, because in the second part, a number of leading people, a number of prominent figures of the society are asked either they are giving particular time for thinking or not. Understood it? Listen once again what is written. This chapter is very easy, but the thing is that you have to understand it properly. What was of more interest to me was the second part of the feature in which several leading businessmen were asked about their attitude to thinking. Means here, leading businessmen, means definitely they are the big shots, okay? They are the prominent figures of the society, and they are asked a question, what do they think on thinking? Listen, for eating, we are giving particular time period. To take bath, we are also providing particular time period, 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 1 hour, whatever it is. For study, we are also fixing a particular time, means per day we have to read 2 hours or 5 hours or 8 hours or whatever it might be. So likewise, the question was, either you are giving time for thinking or not. It means you have to sit idle and you have to think on something. Understood? Then only you can find out the solution to a problem. Amongst other things, they were asked when they did their thinking. So, they are not only asked a single question, but they were asked varieties of questions And out of all the questions, they were also asked that when do they thinking? Means when they do think. Josh Ball, Chief Executive Officer, Prudential Bank Securities, said that he set aside 10 to 15 minutes twice a day. Now you might think why we have to provide time for thinking. Yes, we need to provide time for thinking, because if we are not thinking on something, the outcome, the result will be zero. Suppose a particular sum is being given to you, a particular global problem is being given to you. If we are not thinking, then how can you figure it out? How can you sort it out? It is not practically possible. So we must think on something. So Josh Ball, he is providing 10 to 15 minutes per day, twice a day, means two times he used to give 10 to 15 minutes every day. Philip Knight, Chairman, Nick Incorporation, tried to put in 1 hour a day, 3 or 4 days a week. And Philip Knight, who was the chairman of Nike Incorporation, he used to give 1 hour per day. Likewise, he used to give 3 to 4 days in a week. Robert O. Anderson, chairman, Atlantic Richfield, did not set aside any regular time, but found that traveling alone in his private aircraft provided a great deal of thinking time. So another person, Robert O. Anderson, he is the chairman of Atlantic Richfield. He had spoken that he doesn't provide particular time period for thinking, but whenever he used to travel by his private aircraft, at that time he used to get sufficient time for thinking. There were several other comments, and it was interesting to see that many of these senior executives felt able to pinpoint times that were specifically devoted to thinking. And a number of other dignitaries were also asked the question, and it was quite interesting that they also answered it positively. They also told that if they do engage some time for thinking, it would have been very easy to have said that no specific time was allocated to thinking, since a great deal of thinking was taking place at very instant. While looking at a set of figures, whilst listening to someone, whilst communicating, and so on. So sometimes what are we speaking? We do speak that no, I don't give particular time for thinking, but no, you are wrong. Even when we are not giving particular time period for thinking, but still every time we used to think. Right now you are also thinking that why thinking is being emphasized in this chapter. Yes or no? Whenever you are getting up in the early morning, you are also thinking. You are also thinking how much time you will give to your each and every subject. That is thinking. It happens unknowingly. In our subconscious mind, we use it to fix a time for thinking. Understood it? It may be that interviewer had framed the question in such a way that those replying no, they were being asked about specific thinking only time, or it may be that there was a natural distinction between the thinking that was called for by events and while occurred as a reaction of the to the surrounding, and that which required either a deliberate effort or will or the maintenance of a habit. So the people who are framing some questions, they are also thinking before framing the question. So thinking can vary from person to person. Look, it might be our habit to think, or we might be thinking because of the situation. We might think while watching TV, and we might think something whenever we are watching IPL also, okay? And whenever we are watching something else, a beautiful sight, a beautiful anything else, okay? At that time also we can think something, but we can't speak that we never think. Whereas in each and every moment we are thinking only. And it is also important that since all habits require an effort of will in the initial stages and further efforts of will along the way, the distinction may not be that important. So here, for every habit, there is the need of willpower. Suppose every day you are thinking that tomorrow morning I will go for a morning walk. But whenever you parents are calling you by morning 4:30 o'clock, you are speaking, "No, Papa, no, Mama, today I don't want to go. From tomorrow, Pakka, I will go." You are speaking or not? So, there you have less willpower. If you have the strong willpower, if you have the determination, then definitely you can carry out the work as per the proper schedule. So, the same thing is also mentioned here, that willpower is the most important thing, that we have to provide time for thinking. But sometimes whenever we are thinking, we are also being scolded by people. Always only think, don't read. Yes or no? We have curiously ambivalent attitude towards thinking. So, it is also mentioned that we are having positive thinking towards thinking. We are also having some negative feelings towards thinking. Means, thinking is having both positive side as well as negative side. Okay? And it is also important that thinking is a good thing. But thinking is a good thing. If you are thinking something, then only you can find out something. You can find out a clue. You can find out something else. To be able to think is a good thing. If you are able to think, it's a good thing. Then only you are a human being. Because human beings only can think. Animals, they can't think. At the actual employment of thinking seems sometimes to be a sign of weakness. But sometimes, whenever we are thinking something, we think that he is less in knowledge. He is slowed brain. It symbolizes a weakness. I also will prove it by giving you example, don't worry. To have to think about something implies a lack of decisiveness. But sometimes, whenever we are speaking something, by thinking a lot, it implies that we are not deceiving people. We are not cheating people because we have spent our time on that particular matter, on that particular incident, and we did think a lot, then only we are giving the solution. A teacher would rather a pupil came straight out with the answer instead of pausing to think about it. So, when we teachers are asking question to the student, if the student is not answering the question, instantly we are speaking that you have read nothing, stupid fellow. Sometimes we used to speak like this. So, here the same thing is mentioned. Means sometimes whenever we are thinking, it shows that there is less knowledge without. And a politician who made an obvious pause to think about something would be accused of not knowing his own policy on the matter. There are times when we have less regard for a man who thinks than for a man who appears to know all the answers. And when a question is being put to a politician, if the politician is thinking on something, what do we feel? We feel that this person knows nothing on his own agenda. He is only reading out what is being written by someone else. Okay? And some other time, we are also paying too much respect for that person who answers us instantly. But we pay less respect to a person who takes time for thinking. Understood it? After all, if he thinks, he might get it wrong because we are thinking. If you are thinking, you might get wrong. But some other time, there are other times when a man who does not think can or should terrify us. Let me give you one example. Suppose you are asking a question to someone and the person is unable to answer it. And he speaks that, "Give me some time to think." Then you are speaking. It means you don't know it. Yes or no? It means you don't pay respect to the person because he didn't answer your question instantly. But some other time, suppose your friend is having a problem, he told it to you and instantly you gave a solution. Then your friend will speak you without thinking, you are speaking like this. Be serious, think on it, then give me the solution. Understood the point? So, sometimes whenever you are thinking, it is a positive sign because you are serious. Some other times when you are thinking, it's a negative sign that you are less intelligent, you don't have the knowledge. The statement, "I need to think about that," is too often regarded as a sign of weakness or prevarication. So here, what is mentioned? That sometimes whenever we are allotting time, we are giving time for thinking, we are thinking that the person is having less knowledge. And weakness or prevarication means what? Deviation from what is right. Means we are thinking when a person is giving asking for time to think on something, we are thinking that the person is going away from what is right. The person is unable to focus on the point. Perhaps we should alter it to, I don't need to think about it, but I want to and I am going to, but what we have to speak, we have to speak. No, actually I don't want to need to think on it, but I have to think because I do take it seriously. If you are speaking like this, then people also will be serious by looking at your attitude. And what rest is mentioned, this leads on to the notion of thinking that is continued even after the solution has been found. So if you are speaking like this, that I don't want to think but still I want to think, it means you are right and you want to think on a particular thing even when the solution is being found. Okay, so this is your thinking. Now let me tell you, thinking is divided into three categories. Okay, how many categories? Three categories. First one is to think on purpose. First one is three categories: thinking on purpose. Okay, second one is thinking for improvement, and the third one is thinking round and about. Okay, thinking on purpose, thinking for improvement, thinking round and about. Okay, so these are the three types of thinking. I will describe it, what is this and what this one, don't worry. Classically this is problem solving. Okay, the first one is problem solving. You have this problem, you are thinking, you got the problem, thinking stopped. Okay, second one is, this is the problem, you thought you got the solution but still you are thinking, it means you want improvement, you want a better answer. Understood? Then thinking roundabout, problem, you are focusing on every side of a problem, that one is thinking roundabout. Understood the point? Classically this is problem solving. Whether of the open or very close variety, there is an end point, and in this type of thinking there is an end point, ending is there. The thinker is trying to reach some destination, the thinker always try to reach a particular destination. Second one, thinking for improvement. A solution has already been reached, an answer is available, things are going on, the thinker simply wants to do better. So the solution is there, answer is there, problem is sought out, but still the thinker wants for improvement, wants a better result. Now last one is thinking round and about. This is musing, freewheeling, preparing the field, setting the context, exploring the situation, just as an intending purchaser might prowl around a house he is to buy. So the thinker prowls around the situation. There is no definite point of focus. This one is what? Look, suppose you are going to purchase a house. Will you purchase a house by looking it from 100 meter away? Definitely not. You will go inside the house. You will check how many bedrooms are there. You will see the condition of the bath. You will see the condition of the kitchen. Not only this one, you also will touch the walls. You also will check the doors and windows, correct or not. You also will see the cupboards, either it is properly done or not. Then you will move around the house. Okay, you will search in the balcony. You will try to find out where well or tubewell is there. Then you also will go on the roof, correct or not. Means you will focus on everything without a particular point. So likewise, in this type of thinking, the thinker moves round and round, moves on each and every side of a topic, on a problem, without focusing on a central point. Understood? So this is your thinking round and about. It is not normal practice to go on thinking after an adequate solution has been found. But this is not normal that you got a solution still you are thinking. That is, we say wastage of time. There are many very practical reasons for this. The problem that had just been solved may be only of a whole string of problems. The thinker is anxious to move on to the next problem, and the condition might be a number of problems are there. One problem is being sorted out and the thinker is trying to focus on another problem. That's why he is going to think on something else. The thinker is anxious to move on to the next problem. If we don't accept the first solution as being adequate, why should we accept the second? But in this type of thinking, this is thinking stop. But in this type of thinking, solution is there. We are not satisfied. Then can you give the guarantee that we will be satisfied with the second solution? Definitely not. There is no better solution and there is no best one also. This could mean that we are going on thinking with no point of satisfaction. It means we are only thinking, but there is no point of satisfaction. Sir Robert Watson Watt of Radar Frame had a saying, you got one idea today, a better idea tomorrow, and the best idea never. So this person has spoken that today you get a good idea, tomorrow a better idea, but you can never ever get a best idea. Clearly, there has to be a cutoff. There has to be a freezing of the design so that the action, people, means production, etc. can get to work. But there must be some work. It must be done properly. If we suspect that there may be a better solution, then how can we have full confidence in the one we have just found? Listen, here we got a solution. But if we are thinking that we can found a better solution, how can we be satisfied the first one? Practically it's wrong, correct or not? So, if we don't have the full confidence, how can we inspire other such confidence in those people who are encouraging to carry out the solution? If we are not sure that this solution is the best one, then how can we inspire other people to accept this one? When we are also giving more and more time for thinking, when we think that no, this solution is not appropriate, we can't encourage other people also to accept that one. If we don't have the full confidence, we also suspect that a great deal of thinking effort may produce another solution, but one that is only slightly better than the first one. Finally, we may genuinely believe that there can be no better solution, but what is mentioned? It is clearly mentioned that we can get one more good idea, but this one will be slightly better than the previous one, but it can't be the best. So here, finally, we may genuinely believe that there can be no better solution. So finally, we can trust that there is no better solution at all. Okay, so here it is mentioned on your three types of thinking. First one is thinking to achieve a purpose. Second one is thinking for improvement. Third one is thinking round and about. So students, today we have read the chapter A Time to Think, paragraph 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. Okay, so you just read all the 6 lines and while watching the video, go through the text. If you are having any problem, you just ask me. Okay, thank you. Have a nice time.